Okay, thank you, Dean, for your introduction. I will tell a little bit more today about the different radio metals that you can use for labeling biomolecules, so going from small molecules like peptides to antibodies. But that doesn't change the chelate and the chemistry of these radio metals. But before going to that, I want to give you a short overview of what are the typical methods to have to use a radio metal. And that has been reported in 2004. And you can have an integrated approach where the metal is a vital part of your binding, of your receptor binding motif. You can have a targeting molecule with a linker and a chelator with a metal, which is the bifunctional approach. And so here the targeting molecule is completely separated from the chelator and the metal. And the third approach is the peptide hybrid approach, where you have a peptide and that binds to, so the metal binds to some specific peptides. You get in that way a complex that can bind to a receptor. But today I will focus actually on this one, because there you have really the chelator metal complexes that you will form. And that is mostly used also. One other thing I want to mention is when you're going to use radio metals and you have this biomolecule with a bifunctional chelator and a metal, several things can happen in vivo. And here is depicted what can happen. And I will go over all these pathways, but the most important ones I highlighted, that's what you actually want to have. That's, of course, receptor binding. And furthermore, it should be excreted as fast as possible to get a high tumor to non-tumor ratio in case of tumor targeting. But the other things are also very important, and you should take that in mind when you're going to make such type of complexes and you're going to analyze your compounds, your data. So what you don't want, of course, is metal competition. You should be sure that your metal is firmly bound in your chelator, and it should not be that, for instance, the iron in the body is competing with your metal in this chelator. Other things that you don't want is decomposition. Your chelator and your bifunctional chelator should be firmly bound to your targeting molecule. Protein binding, it sometimes happens that you want to have that in case, for example, with nanobodies, where you want to have an increased half-life of your nanobody, but most of the time you don't want this because it will compete with your receptor binding. Then metabolism, of course that happens, but most of the time you want to really look at the intact product and not to the metabolized parts of it. Then dissociation, of course, is not what you want. The metal should stay in the bifunctional chelator, and there shouldn't be chelator competition. So these are important things to consider when you're going to make when you're going to use radio metals. If you want to change, for example, your pharmacokinetics of your complex, you can think of the following things. So you can do a chemical modification of your biomolecule. You can incorporate, for example, peg change. Chains to enhance your biological half-life. And of course, the metal chelate, you can use different chelators with different charge and hydrophilicity, as also was pointed out in the lecture before. You can use different linkers. And for example, in the case of technetium, you can have different co-ligands, and that will determine the fate of your complex. Here's an overview of what I want to discuss. The different radio metals that I want to that I would like to discuss. I will start with technetium, then go to gallium and indium. They have comparable chemistry, so I'll discuss the chemistry of these radio metals together. Then the copper isotopes, the lutetium and yttrium is also comparable, and then finally zirconium, which I'm mostly involved with in daily practice. But if you see all these radionuclides, yeah, what should you use? So I think that is mainly depending on the time to reach your target, especially if you look at the physical half-life of your radionuclide, the target properties. I'm now talking about radiometals, but if you also take into account, for instance, iodine isotopes, it can be very important, for instance, in tumor targeting. If you have an internalizing antibody, for example, then you shouldn't use iodine because it will be released from the tumor and come back in the bloodstream. Then other things you should consider, of course, are the nuclear properties, the half-life, as I just said, the type of radiation. Do you want to do SPECT or PET imaging? If you want to go to the clinic, what is available? And what is the energy of the radionuclides? But also important, I think, is costs and availability. But most of the time, you don't want to think about that. So I go through the different radiometals and tell something about the physical properties, how it is produced, how it decays, and something about the chemistry. So technetium-99m is still the workhorse of nuclear medicine. I think about 80% is still technetium that is used in the clinic. And technetium is produced from molybdenum. And molybdenum you can get on a generator. And it is a fission product with a half-life of about 3 days. And technetium is the technetium-99m is the metastable form of technetium-99 and has a half-life of about 6 hours. And it decays with a gamma ray emission of 140 kilo electron volt to technetium-99. So technetium-99m you can elute from such a generator. So the molybdenum is absorbed on the generator and via elution with saline, technetium comes off and molybdenum sticks to the column. And such type of generator you can use for about a week. And what you get off the generator is technetium pertechnetate, and that has oxidation state 7 and cannot be used as such. And thus you should reduce it. You need a reducing agent, of course a chelator, and the reaction conditions actually determine what type of technetium complex you get. And technetium 5 complexes that are mostly formed, and that's also the best controlled chemistry also. The technetium 5 complexes I will only discuss here because technetium is very rich. It's very rich chemistry, but I want to also discuss the other isotopes, of course. So technetium 5 complexes mostly use simple Cygna donors like nitrogen, oxygen, and sulfur. And as Dean also said, here the stability, the tetradentate is more stable than if you would have 4 monodentate ligands. And thiol ligands are preferred and 4 are more stable than alkyl ligands. Then the gallium isotopes. There are 2 gallium isotopes. At least these are the most often used. That's gallium-67, which is the SPECT isotope. And it can be produced in a cyclotron from zinc-68. And it has a half-life of about 3 days. And it decays by electron capture and several gammas, which are depicted here. Then if you look at gallium-68, that's a PET isotope, and it is produced from a generator, from a germanium-68. And germanium-68 has a half-life of 270 days, and gallium-68 has a half-life of about 68 minutes. And it decays via beta plus and some gammas. And you can have such a generator in your lab and use it for about 1 to 2 years because of the very long half-life of your germanium mother, your parent isotope. Then indium, which is a SPECT isotope. It can also be produced in a cyclotron, and it has a comparable half-life to gallium-67. But here you can see that it has only 2 main gamma energies. If you look at the chemistry of this gallium and indium, it's pretty comparable. They're in both in group 3b of the periodic table. And under physiological conditions, the only oxidation state is 3+. And as Dean also told us about the size, gallium is very small and is a very hard acid. And this prefers hard donors like nitrogen and oxygen. And since indium is a little bit larger, you also have there sulfur as a ligand. If you look at what type of complexes they form. The six coordinate complexes are the most stable, also in vivo. And but one thing to remember, and what is very important if you're going to work with gallium or indium, is that it's pretty similar to iron. And you should always look at the stability and look, for example, if transferrin can interfere with your complex. If you look at gallium and indium and iron, you can see that the ionic radius of iron is comparable to gallium. You can also see that the log K for hydroxides is much higher than for ammonia and sulfur atoms. And that's also a very important issue. If you're going to work, for instance, with gallium, you should keep the pH as low as possible to prevent that you get gallium hydroxides and all type of precipitates. And one other thing is, what is very important is that you watch out for transferrin, because if it's not, your gallium is not stably coupled to your chelator, you will probably see that gallium and indium accumulates in the liver and lungs. So that's not because the radiometal itself is accumulating there, but it's because it's then bound to transferrin, and that has a high binding capacity for the liver and the lungs. The chelates for gallium and indium are depicted here, and because indium is a little bit larger than gallium, it also has a, let's say it like this. Gallium works best with DOTA, as Dean also told. It can work with DOTA, but you need higher temperatures. But indium is a perfect match with DOTA. And if you then look at the acyclic ligands, indium, you can use these two type of chelates for indium, but the macrocyclic ligand is better for its stability. Then the copper isotopes. As you can see here, there are a large variety of copper isotopes. And also, they differ in their half-life. So it goes from 10 minutes to 62 hours. They're a different emission. So there are some therapeutic isotopes, which are copper-64 and copper-67. Some PET isotopes and also mixed isotopes like copper-64. The choice of your copper isotope is really dependent, I think, on what type of compound you prepared. And yeah, if you want to do copper therapy with antibodies, I would always choose copper 67 instead of copper 64 because of the half-life. The copper chemistry is much more easy than, for example, the technetium chemistry, and it has two oxidation states. Copper 1 and copper 2, and at least in aqueous solution. And these, what you form is really dependent on the ligands that you use. And the copper 1 complexes, they mostly have soft polarizable donors like thioethers, phosphines, isonitriles, and iodides, while the copper 2 complexes are more hard soft, and they have also, they have nitrogen and sulfur ligands. If you look at what you should use, which copper isotope, I think it's really dependent on your targeting molecule. If you have a small molecule, a large molecule, so the biological half-life determines the physical half-life that you want for your copper isotope. If you look, for instance, to short-lived copper radionuclides, you can use them, for example, for the lipophilic SS blood flow agents, so it should be neutral complexes, and you can use the shorter-lived copper isotopes. There is also less important how stable it is compared to if you're going to prepare large molecules like antibodies with copper. Because in the time that it's targeting, it has not yet decomposed. Well, for antibodies, it's a long circulating protein. It takes a long time to target the tumor, for example. There it's very important that you have a stable chelate metal complex. And so it should be stable enough to clear the blood and diffuse into the target tissue. If you look to longer-lived copper radionuclides, if you want to label, for example, biomolecules, there it's very important that it's firmly bound. And as Dean already told about the different type of chelators, I will also come to that a little. There it's very important that it's very stable in vivo, of course. And that also determines your chelator, and the macrocyclic chelators are preferred. And if you look at the different choices of chelators, there are really a bunch of copper chelators available. And I think especially if you look at peptides and so on, you can choose the different chelators. I think there it's very important that you look at what is the best one for your best, the highest tumor to background ratio. So if you look at the first, let's say the first generation chelators for copper, that is DOTA and TETA, that's at least what I understood, that they thought that they were very stable. But with the second generation copper chelators, like these bridged side clamps, so the CBTE2A, they were much more stable. And also these Diamsar, SAR, so more like these claws, they form very stable complexes with copper. Then I'd like to continue with lutetium and yttrium. Lutetium is a SPECT isotope, and it also decays via beta minus, so it's also can be used for therapy. There's a pretty long half-life, about a week, and it decays via 3 beta minus emissions and 2 gamma ray emissions. If you look at yttrium, there are 2 isotopes mostly used. It's yttrium-86 and yttrium-90. Yttrium-86 is a PET isotope and has a half-life which is comparable to copper-64. But as you can see, the decay of the yttrium-86, the beta plus energy is rather high, and it has a lot of gamma energies also. So that are things that you should take into account if you're going to choose between yttrium, for example, and copper-64 or maybe other radio metals. This is a PET isotope, and yttrium-90, I don't have a slide for that, which is a pure therapeutic isotope, has a half-life of about 3 days, and it only emits beta minus, and it has a higher energy than, for instance, the lutetium, so that can also determine what type of therapeutic isotope you want to use. The chemistry of these 2 metals is comparable, and they also favor the 3+ oxidation state. And these 2 metals have similar charge, ionic radius, and coordination chemistry. And DOTA is the preferred chelator for these metals, and it gives better, more stable complexes than, for instance, GTPA. And the last metal I want to discuss is zirconium. Zirconium is also a PET isotope, and it has a half-life of about 3 days. It can be produced in a cyclotron, and it decays with the beta plus and an electron capture, and also a gamma of 900 kiloelectron volt. The chemistry of zirconium is actually very simple. Zirconium is a hard Lewis acid, and thus prefers hard Lewis bases like nitrogen and oxygen, and mostly oxygen actually. And it's known that it forms very stable complexes with hydroxamates. And this is a hydroxamate group. And it prefers 8 coordination. Then there's 1 chelator available for zirconium, which is desferrioxamine or desferol. And that consists of 3 hydroxamate groups and an amine for linking, for example, to your biomolecule. And desferrioxamine is already used in the clinic for years for iron overload and aluminum overload, and it can be used for complexation of iron, gallium, and also zirconium. And there are different type of linkers attached to desferrioxamine, and some are stable, some are not. And then I want to discuss some things that I already told about the different radio metals and the chelators. And I think this is more applicable to small molecules like peptides than for antibodies, because there the antibody is so large, the targeting molecule, the chelator and the metal are not so much important. But especially for small molecules like peptides, yeah, they're the size of the and the charge and so on of the chelator are important. So what are the differences if you change a metal ion, if you change the chelator but keep the same metal? And what is the effect of changing a linker? And there have been multiple studies. If you look in literature, you can, I think, there's an overload of that. And I picked three examples. The first one is an example where they changed the radio metal. Here they used DOTATOC, somatostatin, for the somatostatin receptor. And they radio labeled it with gallium 67, indium 111, and yttrium 90. And they compared it with indium 111 octreoscan, which has a few changes in the peptide backbone. And I picked out one graph from this article, and that was the kidney uptake that changed a lot by changing the metal and the tumor uptake. And as you can see, hopefully it's not very clear, but if you go from left to right, it's indium octreoscan, indium DOTATOC, yttrium DOTATOC, and gallium DOTATOC. And as you can see, if you, these three are comparable. If you change the metal, you can see that there's a decrease in uptake in the kidney. And especially if you compare these two, of course, but that are different peptides. If you then look at the tumor uptake, I think there's the effect is even more remarkable. If you go from indium to yttrium to gallium, you see a large increase in tumor uptake. The most profound effect is seen after 1 hour, but also after 24 hours, you still see that this effect is there. So you can see by simply changing the metal for, of course, this small molecule, that can have a major effect on your tumor uptake in this case and kidney uptake. Then the second example is where they looked at the different chelators and radiometals. So they have also somatostatin for the somatostatin receptor peptide, LM3. And here's depicted NODAGA. So it's the NODA with the backbone here on one of the side chains. And they compared it with these two chelators attached on this position. So the CBTE2A and the DOTA. And they radio labeled it with gallium and or copper 64. The first thing they looked at is the IC50 of these complexes. And as you can see, for example, if you change from NODAGA to DOTA, the IC50 value goes up about tenfold. And probably this is also what you will see in the tumor uptake in vivo. So here are two graphs I took from the article. And this is for the copper isotope. So the copper was attached to the CBTE2A and the NODAGA. And you can see that they looked at 4 and 24 hours post-injection. And you can see that the tumor blood ratio of this NODAGA is much better than the cross-bridged theta. And I think here the effect is not so big, but if you look at the tumor kidney ratios and also liver and muscle ratio, there's a really big difference due to the chelator. If you look at the gallium NODAGA and the DOTA, it's depicted a little different, but probably more familiar to most of you. If you look here at the tumor uptake of the NODAGA compound, it's much larger than the DOTA compound. And also here, if you look at the tumor to muscle ratios, this is not so much a big of a difference, but the kidney uptake, it's twice as high. It's also, of course, because here the kidney uptake is lower than this one. And it all has to do with the different chelators. Then a third example, which is not as profound as the other two examples. Here they looked at the bombacin analog, and they labeled it with they coupled DOTA to it with different type of chelators, of a different type of linkers. And they labeled it all with indium. And so they had aliphatic change in between the DOTA and the bombacin analog. and some aromatic linkers. And I took one picture from the article, and that's where they did the imaging. I think it's not very clear from this what the differences is of the different linkers, but what they saw is that one day post-injection, the groups with the aromatic linkers showed a better tumor retention. This effect was much smaller compared to the other two examples, but at least you can play around to get as high as possible tumor to background ratio. And this brings me to the last slide of my presentation. Especially with the different examples, I think it's clearly shown that if you have a small molecule, that is very important to make probably different, couple different linkers, different chelators, and different metals to your targeting moiety to get the best compound. And I think that's very important to think of. With antibodies, it's much less important. There you will probably, the thing of the physical properties is more important, but especially with smaller proteins, I think here that you can gain a lot. Thank you.